Hello, greetings dear ones. I'm taking a stroll today and it's just rained and it's looking so fresh and beautiful. Isn't that amazing? It's still drizzling a bit. I'm just taking a stroll here. Today is Thursday and tomorrow is supposed to be Good Friday. So I was just contemplating on something and then I had some deep insight which I thought I immediately make a video and share it with you. The message of Good Friday, the real true message of Good Friday. Real means, I mean, the essence of Good Friday. What does it mean when it says Jesus died for us, Jesus Christ? Many Christians talk about this as Jesus Christ died for us or died for our sins. But ironically, from childhood, from my very little years of living, I have asked this question to many people, including my parents and including priests and elders, while going to church. What does this mean that Christ died for us or died for our sins? How can he die for our sins? Sins that somebody else has done and the whole population has done, and why should he die and how should he die and how does this make sense? And to tell you, nobody could give me the answer. So this burning question was always there in my mind, being born in a Roman Catholic family. This was always there in my mind, and then I kept on pondering. And once I got into meditation and a real life of spirituality and living that kind of spiritual life, slowly all these answers came to me from within. And it was only due time, some time it took for me to just confirm with these things. And once I was convinced and I had conviction, I started sharing these messages of Christ, Jesus Christ. Now Jesus Christ, for believers or non-believers, there are believers who believe in Christ and there are non-believers who don't believe that there was somebody like that, or some say it is just a mythology or a story, or well, historical evidences are there, a lot of evidences are there, but I don't want to go into all that, because then I will be again falling into that bracket of debating about Christ or any mighty being, any avatars. It is always debatable. If you go by logic, if you go by evidence, which what your five senses can catch, it is always, always debatable. And it is never ending and it has no conclusion. So let us not fall into that trap. What I want to actually share in this message is the beautiful message of the Christ consciousness, the consciousness, because that is all what we are evolving towards developing Christ consciousness, or you might call it Krishna consciousness. The consciousness of somebody of that stature, somebody which we know as God, as close to that God, that divine being, we can relate this consciousness, Christ consciousness or Krishna consciousness, as good as that supreme being, as divinity or God, whatever you call it. So the closest being which we can refer in Christianity, closest being to God, is in the human form, is somebody known as Jesus Christ. So now he died for us, and that is what Good Friday is about. And tomorrow is Good Friday. Now why is it good? Why I'm thinking about this is because I was just talking today to my physiotherapist, and just like that, and she happened to ask me about the holidays that we have, Good Friday. And then I told her the actual meaning of Good Friday. I said, I don't go into those any ritualistic, I cannot, be it of any faith, I somehow cannot relate with any rituals. It's direct, inner connection, the Advaitic or non-dualistic aspect or approach. So how I see it and how my heart or my soul perceives all these things, I just told. And it vibed well with her. She could understand that. So why is it called Good Friday and supposed to be mourning? You know, most of the believers actually mourn on Good Friday. Mourn what? Mourning the death of Jesus Christ. Mourning means they feel sad about Jesus Christ being tortured and killed, and who died and had to die at the hands of humanity. So that is what it means by mourning. They all mourn the sad event. They go into mourning. So if it is morning, then why is it called as Good Friday? Friday is supposed to be a sad Friday. Why it is Good Friday? Good because the event that happened for the good of humanity. How? That's what I'm trying to say. How can he have died for a good cause? Now, when we say that somebody died for our sins, it is not a mythical thing, or it is not something that is very difficult to understand, because in those days, okay, we can say there was somebody like Christ and he died for our sins, or he took the karma of people. When we say died for our sins is karma, negative karma. So when people sin, mass consciousness sin a lot, and somebody like the stature of Christ is present in that population, what happens is there is an automatic absorption of that negativity by this being, and it can be conscious or it can be unconscious. Now we are not debating again, was it conscious or unconscious. There are live examples that has happened even in this century or last century with many such mighty beings who have actually taken on karma of people or the collective or the people around them. So many saints, many mystics, many avdhuts have already known to be in this kind of state where they have actually died for a good cause. Take for example Shirdi Sai Baba. He lived as much as he could live in the presence of the population. And what kind of population got attracted to him? Obviously, those who had heavy karma. Those who had positive and those who had of greater consciousness. Why would they come to an evolved being? The evolved being always attracts people of lower consciousness or those who have heavy karmic debts. So, around the vicinity of Sri Sai Baba, if you see, a lot of negative karma was always there, and you could see Sai Baba on and often ill because he was consciously or unconsciously taking on the karma of people who came in his vicinity. Take the examples of so many other saints. Take Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, for example. Take Ramana Maharshi, for example. These were great mighty beings. And why do they take karma? Do they take consciously or subconsciously? Consciously, there are many people who have taken, and there are many examples that I can say. I can share it from my own life example, where I have seen, I have experienced my master doing that. I don't want to go into details, but I have seen it and I have conviction. So it is possible. So it is possible at two ends. One is consciously you do it because you love somebody or you care for somebody so much, or you want to help somebody. Consciously it's done. Unconsciously it's done when the compassion of that being, mighty being, flows out so earnestly or so easily, and that compassionate being cannot see the suffering, or they are so empathic towards the suffering of others that they generally attract karma of others, and that's how they subconsciously take or unconsciously take. But in any case, conscious or unconscious, they are least bothered about the effects of it. Whether it happens to them, doesn't happen, they are not bothered, because these are mighty beings who just go by the flow. Whatever has to happen will happen. They go in that manner, so they are not bothered. So Christ is one among them, just like that. So maybe in those days it is very difficult to relate to how this can happen, but if you see in the current eras also, you can see a lot of such mighty beings who are doing this. So obviously Christ conscious, the consciousness of Christ was so large, so huge, so vast, that he could accumulate. The larger, the vaster the consciousness, the more you accumulate, the more power you have to actually accumulate or take on and burn. Most of the cases, they take on and they burn. That's how many saints or many avdhut, many mystics, they continue living their life doing that. I have seen so many mistakes in my life. The mystics who actually take on and get sick and they get well because they burn it off. And then they again fall sick. I've seen Avadhutas here in Karnataka also, who did that all their life. And there are no complaints. You know, when they burned karma, you know, they were suffering. They were not actually suffering. Their body was suffering. And they were okay with it. So those days, the Avadhuta would not see. There was an Avadhut in Karnataka whom I used to met. He was known as some Ajja. I forgot. Navanur Ajja something. Nagnur Ajja something like that. That was the first Avadhut I met. And he would not give darshans when he was totally sick. And he used to get admitted in hospitals, all those things. People used to take him and all that, you know. And it almost like months it used to take for him to recover. But he used to be perfectly all right after a certain months. And when he's all right, he would start giving darshans. And people flocked to him. And this went on for months. And again, he fell sick. There are beings who do this. So it's not difficult for me to believe or know what Christ went through or what he did. So when we say Jesus Christ died for the good of all, or he died for the sins of all, or he died for the sake of others, this is what it means. The mass collective karma that he took over himself, and that resulted in the following events that happened in his life. And that is why he did not grumble. If you observe this very carefully, that's what I just told you. These mystics also don't grumble about it, because they know, they are aware of it. And when they are aware of it, they silently go through it, just like Jesus did. If you see, there was no rantings. He never complained. He never debated. He never fought back. He never argued. He had nothing to do. He was just going with the flow, whatever happened, whatever they did to him. He was absolutely fine. And in the end, on Good Friday, on that Friday when they were crucifying him and they were torturing him, nailing him on that cross, all that he could say was, look up to the divine and say, Lord, forgive them. God or Father, forgive them. For they do not know what they are doing. They know not what they are doing. Means he was at such level of consciousness to understand. You're so evolved to understand the consciousness of somebody else, to know that their consciousness has not yet evolved to that state where they can even understand or discriminate between right and wrong. What they are doing, they don't know. They are doing it out of certain tendencies. So he could see, and from that space he could forgive. Forgiveness was very simple for him, easy for him, because he was able to relate to what others are doing to him. And from that space, he had still compassion for those who even tortured him. So he could see that they are, you know, they are so stuck up in their ignorance. And he could also see what kind of karma are they inviting into their lives while they are doing this kind of an act. He knew the consequences, and that is why this being who was all the life taking on the negative karma of people, even at the end stage of his life, was concerned about their karma. So he was praying to the divine, saying that, Lord, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He was praying so that they be forgiven, so that karma be nullified. What would a normal person do? An average human being do? If somebody is torturing, they would have cursed him. Even if they wouldn't have cursed him, they wouldn't have still prayed for somebody's good. They would have said, okay, let God handle it, or let karma handle it, I am not cursing. You know, and somebody who is beyond this. So you can imagine the stature, the level of consciousness. That is why we call it as Christ consciousness. A very evolved state of consciousness. So this is what happened on a Good Friday. He died for the good of all with a powerful message of forgiveness, non-violence, even come what may. Going through everything and going through the the trivials of life, the trials of life, the obstacles, the challenges of life, and yet not ranting about it, yet witnessing and observing everything. He was the perfect state of awareness. He was in perfect state of awareness, perfect state of witnesshood, where he was witnessing everything. He was not at all freaking out on anything. So that's the most beautiful message that Christ would have given on this beautiful day of Good Friday. And that is what came to my consciousness as I started connecting to Christ consciousness. Connecting off the people and rituals and the logic and you know, the customs and traditions and cultures and all that, because they were not answering my question, okay? Because I need answers to my questions. So, and that when the Christ consciousness, when I could directly connect to that Christ consciousness, these things came in very deeply, very clearly, the deep insights. And that I could relate with my life experiences, and I could relate with all the saints and the mystics who already lived in that state. So I could relate very well. Oh, this is how Christ did it or went through all this. So I thought I'll share this message. And yes, 3 days, after 3 days, it is said that he was raised up. You know, it sounds very dramatic. Somebody died and he rose up and went to heaven. It's not just like that. There are some possibilities which we do not know. We do not believe in certain things because we have not seen or we have not come across some experiences or any such news. But I am telling you, even the 18th century, 19th century, there has been incidences where you can transcend the level of body consciousness and you can even evolve or dissolve your body, physical body, at the time of death, so-called death, because there is actually no death. The soul just leaves the body, and in this case, it's the soul leaves by wrapping up the body itself. That is something that is called ascension. So in Christianity, there's something called the ascension of Christ, that is on Easter day. He rose from the dead. He immediately did not ascend, he rose from the dead. He was supposed to be in that. And what happened in the 3 days is, obviously he was one of the greatest healers. He could heal so many, the multitudes. Don't you think, if somebody has the power to heal somebody, they have the power to heal themselves. First, they need to know the science of healing themselves, then only they can heal others. So it was not absolutely necessary until this karmic event had to take place and had to be nullified. Once the suffering was taken over and a large amount of karmic consequence was dissipated, then he began the healing in the 3 days inside the tomb. And in the third day, he rose, he vanished out of that tomb. So it sounds very dramatic, but it's not dramatic, it's very scientific. And then he appeared to his closest disciple, Saint Thomas, first, and who was so scared. He freaked out, saying, "This is a ghost, you cannot be Christ. You are dead, how can you be here?" And Jesus tries to convince him in so many ways, but he doesn't listen. He's freaked out because it is not in the experience of any average human being to just have that kind of an experience, to see a dead man come alive. And then Christ takes his, it said that he takes his hand and touches his wound, which is very fresh and where he was pierced in the chest. And then he realizes, oh, this is a real Christ, his master. And then a lot of revelations were done and given, his final instructions were given to the disciple. And in front of everybody and a group of people, he rose up with his body, along with his body. So this also sounds very dramatic, but I'm telling you, it's not dramatic, because I have been studying the Avadutas, the mystics, all my life. And I've come across so many mystics who have had, you know, so many profound experiences, who left back so many profound experiences. There have been, forget everything, even late 18th century, just the beginning of 19th or late 18th century, we had a very great mystic called Ramalinga Swami in Vadalur. He is also known as Vallalar there in South India. So if you look at what he did, and it's all recorded, it appeared in the newspapers. He just vanished, he turned into light, he turned his body into light as his mission was over. He turned into light. Why was he able to do that? Because he was purified to that level. His consciousness was so much purified that he could actually do it. And he did it. You can study the case of Ramalinga Swami and you'll see that he did it. So that's a good evidence of how these things can happen. And there are many multitude. There are many, many, many saints. Not just one. There are many. You take Saint Tukaram. You take many mystics. You just study them. You'll come to know there are many who have turned into light. There are many who have ascended with their bodies, with the human body. Because the human body is no more in that imperfect state, they have perfected it to such a purified state of consciousness, and it is possible. Though in these times, it's very difficult. Any time, any era, if you see, it's not so easy, because it takes something to reach to that stature. And that is why we don't find these things in common, and that is why it is hard to believe. So anyways, the third day, he rose, and that is Easter, and they celebrate. So the true message, this true celebration that we have of Good Friday and Easter is this. The message of Christ consciousness, that everybody can become like Christ, because he came to tell everybody that you can become Christ-like. He did not say, I am God, here, worship me. He never said that. He said that you can become like me. And he gave examples of all the possibilities, of all the impossible possibilities, which I am narrating here. And the tendencies of divine tendencies, the divine nature of forgiveness, acceptance, and unconditional love. He gave it through his practical life. And when you give it through practical life, only you can actually walk the talk and say that this is what happened. This can happen to you. And that is how Christ actually delivered the message of Good Friday and Easter. So I believe if we take the messages in this stature, it is going to affect our life somewhere, rather than just believing that somebody came and somebody went and mourning, oh my God, he died for us, and how could they have killed, and how could they have done such miserable things. And you know, this is because we fail to go further beyond what we know and what we hear. So only when we know it, the knowing comes through your deep insights, through direct connection with that Christ consciousness. I'm telling you, he's alive. Christ is alive. He's not dead. Consciousness can never die. An average person also never dies, and he is of such big stature. He's still moving around. He moves around in through realms, different realms and dimensions. There is work going on. On the earth plane, his work was this. So his work never ended there. And they are invited to other realms. And this goes on continuously. Continuously this goes on. They are like almost forever until the final ascension of all the collective happen. This is why they are around. So if you understand this, and then if you connect to that Christ consciousness, I'm telling you, my God, everything will be revealed to you. Everything will be revealed unto you. And all this began, if I can go a little more deeper, this Christ had very clearly indicated, Jesus has indicated this, because he, in his living, when he was actually one day moving through one of the temple of God, where they actually worship God, and the temple is supposed to be a sanctified divine place, clean, purified place. But when he enters the temple, what has happened? What happens is he sees all the people there, all the big shots and all the guys who are supposed to govern, and you know, the teachers, the Pharisees, all those people. They are actually doing business in the temple of God. They are selling stuff, they are, you know, gambling, the pigeons were being sold, lot of activities happening there, like a market. And Christ, for the first time ever recorded, was angry. He's not supposed to be an angry man. He has that human nature and that tendency of getting angry, because he was very upset that the temple of God, the place of worship, a place that is supposed to be so pure, is being abused by people, ignorant people. So he came and he overturned everybody's tables. He threw it up and he literally whipped out the people out of the temple, and he says, this is the temple of God, do not dare to do business here. In the temple of God, there is no business here. This is a message to us. This is the message to even today's world. In the temple of God, there should be no business. And when he did that, he obviously developed a lot of enemies. And from there, he knew immediately the consequence of doing that. Even you have consequences. Today, if somebody speaks out truth, or somebody stands up for righteousness, or somebody does something like this, they know the consequences. Persecution. So he knew it. And when he knew it, he also indicated and he spoke about it. He said, destroy this temple. This temple, he was looking at the temple which these people had abused the temple of God. He says, destroy this temple of God and I shall raise it in 3 days. And those people who were ignorant about all this, they were confused. 3 days? This temple took years to build and you're going to build it in 3 days? Rebuild it in 3 days? He said, I shall do that. But he was actually referring to his own body, the human body, which is actually supposed to be the temple of God. This body, this is another beautiful message. This body is nothing less than the temple of God, because this is where God dwells. The true God dwells within this body. So the message is to keep the body pure. Anything wrong going on inside the body, mind, emotions, feelings must be immediately overturned and driven out, whipped out. There should be no mercy there. It should be immediately returned to its original state of purity and sanctity. And this is Jesus. This is the Christ consciousness. We have a consciousness. So if we have an evolved consciousness, what happens is our consciousness will not allow any demons to work within us. Immediately the consciousness will act upon it, whatever the consequences. And the consequences cannot be too dire. Cannot be. Because you cannot be killed. The consciousness cannot be killed. The body may perish, not the consciousness. But here Christ challenged, even if you touch the body, even if you destroy the body, I shall rebuild it in 3 days. What does he mean? Even if you kill or damage this body, I shall restore it, I shall heal it in 3 days. And that is what he exactly did in Good Friday. On Good Friday, he was killed, supposedly killed. He, in 3 days, restored his body, brought back the temple to its original sanctified position, and he ascended. That's the deepest message of Good Friday and Easter, which Christ consciousness talks about. I'm glad to have connected to that consciousness, where I get these insights very clear, crystal clear, and I can relate it with what's happening in our today's world also. So I thought I can share this beautiful message of Christ to you on these 3 beautiful days that's coming, and let us know the true essence of what it is. It's not just in worshipping something. It's not just in putting up a photograph or, you know, an idol and worshipping it. Worshipping somebody else for being great. No, the Christ message is, you can be great, you can be godly. You are godly. You are the child of God, the son of God, the daughter of God, the child of God. So, to enter that kingdom, entering that kingdom is entering that state, that evolved, the liberation that happens, the mukti, the moksha is entering into the kingdom of God, which is pure consciousness, divine consciousness. So, that's the ultimatum. So, he says, if you want to enter the kingdom of God, become like this, Christ conscious. The consciousness should be elevated to the level of Christ consciousness. So, this is the beautiful message of Good Friday and Easter. With this, I take your leave. May we all evolve. Stay blessed.